Macmillan Audio presents Other People's Pets by R.L. Maizes, read by Devon Sorvari. Prologue. Winter 1999. 1 minute, Lala joins a flock of geese skating across the lake as they fly overhead, and the next, squeak, crack, she plunges into darkness. Her snowsuit inhales icy water and clings to her, weighing her down and threatening to pull her under. Though she tries to tread water, her skates are too heavy. She opens her mouth to scream, and the lake rushes down her throat. Just when she thinks she'll drown, she sees her mother. Mama! She gurgles. But the woman who calls herself Mother turns and skates away. Frigid black water tugs at Lala's ankles, pours concrete into her muscles. She goes under. Still and cold, it's the loneliest place she's ever been. Too dark to see anything that might thrive there. Perfectly silent until the sharp bark of a dog cuts through the water, summoning her back. Maybe help has arrived. Remembering swim lessons her father gave her, Lala gathers her strength and frog kicks to the surface. 10 feet away, a black dog awaits her. She swims toward him, reaching the edge of the hole in the ice. Hands on the white mass, she pushes as hard as she can, but can't raise herself. She frog kicks again, desperate to stay above water. The dog howls. Urged on by the animal, and no longer alone, she presses her arms against the surface of the ice, but lacks the strength to lift herself out. Exhausted, the cold stiffening her muscles, she waits to sink again. But this time she doesn't go under. The arms of her jacket have frozen to the ice. That's all she remembers. Later, she learns a man and woman arrived to skate. They found the dog keeping watch, Lala unconscious, attached to the ice. On her cell phone, the woman called emergency services, who rescued Lala. The dog bounded into the woods before anyone could reward him. No one knew whose dog he was or where he had come from. It wasn't until Lala was being loaded into an ambulance that her mother returned. She had gone to get help, she said. From under warm covers the next morning, Lala hears a dove cuckoo to its mate. The bird's heart thrums with excitement. When her own pulse takes up the beat, Lala doesn't know what to make of it. 1. Fall 2015. In exam room 4, Lala rubs the silky muzzle of a Labrador retriever named Duck. A woman who looks to be in her 30s pales as she points out a lump on the Labrador's side, but focusing on the dog, Lala barely notices the owner's anxiety. She takes a history and performs an exam. Soft and movable, the growth is probably a harmless lipoma. "What do you think?" the woman says. Lala knows better than to offer a diagnosis before the resident has seen the patient. "I'll get the doctor." With a 22-gauge hypodermic needle, Dr. Munn extracts cells from the lump. Though nowhere near the tip, Lala feels the prick as it goes in. The doctor shows her the cells under a microscope, then gives the owner the good news. It's a benign, fatty tumor, just as Lala suspected. Pleased to give the dog a reprieve, Lala remembers why she loves her work, even the general practice rotation, which others find dull. Her exhaustion from working 12-hour days fades. Color returns to the owner's face. "I don't know how to thank you both." "We're glad to help," Dr. Munn says. When Lala is silent, the doctor clears her throat. She turns to Lala expectantly. "Glad to help," Lala parrots, already thinking about her next patient. An hour later, Lala prepares to place an IV in a border collie's cephalic vein. The dog must have eaten peanut butter biscuits in the waiting room. They make Lala's tongue feel sticky and thick. She shaves a spot on the dog's front leg and scrubs the site with alcohol and chlorhexidine before inserting the needle. She can hardly believe in less than a year she'll be graduating and seeing patients of her own. When the phone in her pocket goes off, it isn't the ringtone for her fiancé, Clem, doctor, doctor, give me the news, or her father, Zev, run, daddy, run, so she puts it out of her mind. Treating a nervous, aging poodle, Lala scratches above the dog's heart and feels a pleasurable ache in her own chest. You're a champ, Gordy, she says after drawing his blood, but the dog doesn't look at her or otherwise seem to hear. She walks the poodle to the waiting room, where a man in a navy suit reaches for the leash.
He never greets me at the door anymore, he says, his voice quavering.
He's not a butler, Lala mutters.
Excuse me.
Could be his hearing. He is an older dog. In the break room, a tofu and avocado sandwich in one hand, Lala finally taps the phone message. Hearing John O'Bannon's voice, she stops chewing. O'Bannon is an attorney who represented Zev and Lala in a burglary case when she was a teenager.
Sorry to tell you this, he says. Your dad was arrested. Bail hearing is tomorrow at 10. Why don't you stop by this afternoon? I'm still at 329 Carson, second floor.
Lala's throat tightens around a lump of bread. She taps the message again. At the word arrested, she squeezes the sandwich, her fingers punching through the whole grain bread. Zev can't go to prison. He's the only parent she has left. She can't afford to lose him. The sandwich falls apart, avocado streaking the industrial tabletop. Gathering the pieces, she stumbles to the trash and drops them in. She emails Dr. Munn that a family emergency has come up and she'll be out that afternoon. She would tell the resident in person, but doesn't trust herself to speak.
They're charging him with burglary, O'Bannon says.
The lawyer has aged. His cheeks sag. The pores on his nose are big enough to house a fly.
I'll need a $10,000 retainer, but it's going to cost a lot more than that before it's over.
Sloppy piles of official-looking papers rise on his desktop. Crime is as popular as ever. Lala's knee bounces. She wishes O'Bannon brought a dog to work, the kind to lay its muzzle in your lap.
What did Zev say he could give you? When he heard the DA was asking to set bail at $50,000 because a victim was in the hospital, Zev said he'd have to rely on a public defender. He can barely scrape together the $7,500 fee for the bail bondsman.
Lala isn't surprised. What little extra money Zev had, he gave her to help with veterinary school tuition. Though she can't afford to pay O'Bannon either, she hates to turn the case over to a public defender. As a teenager, she watched them in the courtroom while she waited for her own burglary case to be called. They leafed through client files as though they'd never seen them before. She would ask Clem for the money, but he disapproves of Zev's occupation. And besides, what he earns as a chiropractor barely covers their bills. There was a time she would have raised the money herself, breaking into the homes of the wealthy. Some people have more than they need, more than anyone should. But she promised Clem she was finished with that. Lala thinks briefly of her mother. She has no idea where Alyssa is or if she'd be willing to help. Give us a few days to figure something out. The lawyer drums his fingers on his lips.
I suppose that would be okay.
As Lala gets up to leave, she sees on O'Bannon's desk a studio photograph of a harried woman and three robust boys. It's a different family than the one he used to have. Round two, she presumes. Or perhaps the boys are his stepchildren, cared for by a host of mothers and fathers. Growing up, Lala only had Zev. Her mother disappeared when Lala was 8. 4 years later, Lala buried a pair of white cotton underwear at the bottom of the hamper because a constellation of mysterious brown stains convinced her she had an accident. Discovering the panties, Zev said,
"You're a woman now. No need to be ashamed."
Though it was 10 at night, he drove to a supermarket and bought sanitary pads. Returning home, he bleached the underwear. The next day, Zev arranged fruit, 2 lemons, an avocado, and loose purple grapes, on a table and demonstrated how a woman's reproductive system worked.
"Pretty clever design," he said.
He told Lala it was one of the few things his mother had taught him in case he had a daughter. After Zev walked Lala through 2 monthly cycles, they ate the grapes, and Zev made guacamole.
"If you have cramps, we can warm up a hot water bottle," he said while he mixed the garlic and avocado.
Lala scooped a dollop of guacamole onto a chip and opened her mouth.
"Delicious uterus," she said after she swallowed. "Gourmet," Zev said.
When Lala was 13, Zev accompanied her to a department store to buy her first bra.
"Treat her nice," he said to a sales clerk, slipping the woman a 20.
"That's my job, sir," the clerk said, but she stuck the folded bill down the front of her shirt and brought 6 bras to Lala in a communal dressing room. Lala faced a corner while taking off her shirt. She slipped her arms through a bra and struggled to hook the back.
"Here, let me do that for you," the woman said. She yanked the clasp closed, then turned Lala around and tugged on the bra straps to adjust them.
Her fingers were clammy.
Lala selected 2 bras just so she didn't have to feel the woman's hands on her again.
As she rode home with her father, she kept her eyes on the department store bag in her lap. She wondered what it would have been like to shop with Alyssa instead. Her mother's absence, familiar and heavy, squeezed the air from her lungs. Zev caressed the back of her head with his hand.
As if reading her mind, he said, "Not many fathers get to help their girls buy their first bras."
Lala clutched the top of the bag, trying to keep from crying.
"You didn't help me. That woman did. I guess she wasn't your first choice."
"No."
"Sorry about that."
"It doesn't matter," Lala said.
"It matters."
The bag slid off her lap. Zev took her hand, and she let him, just that once. Years afterward, when Lala was in high school, Zev pleaded guilty to a burglary they committed together so that the charges against Lala would be dropped, never mind that it had been Lala's fault they were caught. He was never exactly a candidate for Father of the Year, raising her to be a burglar, homeschooling her, and isolating her from other kids, but she can't afford to think about all that now. The next morning, Friday, Lala emails Dr. Munn that she'll be out again. By mid-afternoon, a bail bondsman has pledged to pay Zev's bail if he fails to appear in court, and Zev is back in his house. Lala pulls up in her Honda and pauses before exiting the car, collecting herself. A dinged-up van with the equipment Zev needs for household re-keys and installations parks in front of the house. "Honesty Locksmith," splashed across the side. Between that and his illegal work, Zev eked out a living, though they had never had the kinds of possessions they saw in homes they robbed, designer goods that didn't come from discount stores. Topped with a coating of Colorado snow, rose bushes line the flagstone path to the front door of the 3-bedroom ranch. Alyssa had cultivated and pruned the flowers every spring, but now they grow wild. Long, barbed branches shoot out in every direction, taller than Lala or her father. No longer fertilized, they nevertheless remain hardy. Lala has begged Zev to trim them, has even offered to do it herself, but he won't hear of it. What she really wants is to dig them up, fill the holes with fresh earth, and forget about them, though she knows that would be impossible. If they were gone, she would search for traces of them, stubborn tendrils winding out of the earth. A fresh scratch from the thorns always marks Zev's face. In the summer, deep cuts fester yellow and green on his exposed arms and legs. He isn't lazy. He paints the house every 5 years, dragging out ladder and drop cloths, mixing the same colors, maroon with white trim. But the bushes are a monument to his wife's treachery, never to be tampered with. Like the flower box that dangles vertically from a single nail. Zev stuffed it with geraniums every Mother's Day, when they still observed the holiday instead of ignoring it, boycotting TV and radio with their endless barrage of ads. The soil in the box has hardened to chalk. Lala circles around to the back door, avoiding the bushes. Her childhood dog, Tiny, died 7 years ago, but Lala still remembers how he'd come bounding toward her. He escaped from the house and was struck by a car while she was in college in Wisconsin. As Lala sat in a biology lecture, pain jabbed her spine, so sharp she passed out. She woke on the floor minutes later.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.